We'll do an exam review of tetanus, tetanospasmin, the clinical features, lab investigations, and the treatment. Few important exam questions before we start the topic and get the answers after the topic is done. Question number one, what's the location of the organisms and the toxins of the Clostridium tetani? Number two, how tetanospasmin reaches the nervous system. Number three, how retrograde neuronal transport occurs. Number four, what's the rate of transport of tetanospasmin and its lethal dose? Number five, when does paralytic tetanus occur? And number six, how long does the passive immunity last from tetanus immune globulin? Now let's discuss tetanospasmin and tetanus. Tetanospasmin is a neurotoxin produced by Clostridium tetani that causes spastic paralytic disease. The other toxin produced by the Clostridium tetani is hemolysin, which is clinically not significant. Clostridium tetani is a gram-positive, motile, anaerobic spore-forming rod with a terminal spore giving it a drumstick appearance. So it's an anaerobic spore-forming gram-positive rod with a terminal spore giving it a drumstick appearance, and a spore survives for many years and 20 minutes of boiling. Clostridium tetani are widely distributed in the nature and in the soil and may cause infection by number one, punctured wounds, for example with a nail prick in the foot, or by a thorn prick on the finger, by tattoos, skin piercing, and the drug abuse. And number three, by ulceration, infection, abscesses, gangrenes, and burns. All these disorders may cause tetanus. The spores starts germinating under favorable devitalized condition when the blood supply is cut off and produces toxins in dirty infected wounds. The organism remains localized in the wound and the toxin is transported by the nerves. So organism remains localized and toxin transported by the nerves to the nervous system. What neurotransmitters do tetanospasmin blocks? Tetanospasmin blocks the release of inhibitory neurotransmitters, GABA and glycine. GABA is gamma-aminobutyric acid at the presynaptic terminal, causing spasticity and rigidity. How tetanospasmin reaches the nervous system? Tetanospasmin does not cross the blood-brain barrier. Neuronal transport is the sole means of entry into the nervous system. It reaches the brainstem and spinal cord by retrograde axonal transport by nerves, and the toxin rate of transport is 3 to 13 millimeters per hour with an incubation period of 4 days to several weeks, usually 1 week depending upon the site of lesion. How retrograde transport occurs? Tetanospasmin is released into the bloodstream. The toxin accesses the presynaptic terminals and binds the terminal axon of the lower motor neurons. It is transported to the nerve cell bodies in the brainstem and spinal cord by retrograde interneuronal transport, where it blocks the neurotransmitters GABA and glycine. Toxin then descends to the presynaptic terminals and blocks the release of GABA and glycine, leaving the resting firing rate of the alpha motor neuron unopposed, producing rigidity. The agonist and antagonist muscles, they contract at the same time, causing spasm and rigidity. It's a very potent toxin and its lethal dose is 2.5 nanogram per kg. So now the sequence of events of the toxin absorption. Tetanospasmin is absorbed in the blood from the site of injury, and then number one, it enters the presynaptic terminals of the lower motor neurons. Number two, it is carried by retrograde axonal transport to the brainstem and spinal cord. Number three, from there, the toxin travels through the descending tract to the anterior horn cells of the spinal cords, the alpha motor neurons, neuromuscular junction, and then to the peripheral nerve endings and prevents the inhibitory neurotransmitter release and cause hypertonia and intermittent muscle spasms. Now, actions of tetanus spasmin at different sites. Since the toxin does not cross the blood-brain barrier, so it does not affect the cerebrocortical neurons by the ascending axonal transport. So, number one, it causes a muscle rigidity at the site of lesion. Number two, it causes generalized tetanus. Toxin enters the blood and lymphatics and distributed widely to the distant nerve terminal. It causes generalized muscle spasm, trismus or lockjaw. Number two, risus sardonicus. What's risus sardonicus? Is the contraction of the facial muscle that causes facial grimacing due to sustained facial muscle contraction and also causes opisthotonus attitude. And what's opisthotonus attitude? It's arched back due to contraction of the back muscle. All the muscles, agonists and antagonists, are contracted, but extensors are more powerfully contracted, giving the body an opisthotonus attitude. So, three important features: generalized muscle spasm, trismus or lockjaw, risus sardonicus or facial grimacing, and opisthotonus attitude. Muscles close to the infection site are, number one, affected more severely and early in the disease, and number two, these muscles, they are last to recover, that is, they remain hypertonic for longer period. Number three, neonatal tetanus occurs due to unsterilized treatment of the umbilical stem. Number four, cephalic tetanus. Cephalic tetanus is a form of localized tetanus and occurs in head injury or in ear infection. And the features of cephalic tetanus are that its incubation period is short, number two, mortality is high, and number three, it causes paralytic tetanus. So, cephalic tetanus causing paralytic tetanus. Sensorium is intact in tetanus, and the death usually occurs in 5 to 10 days due to continuous respiratory muscle spasm and hypoxia. The clinical syndrome appears almost identical to strychnine poisoning. So, tetanus resembles strychnine poisoning, and strychnine poisoning acts by competitively binding to postsynaptic glycine receptors, whereas tetanus toxin blocks the release at the presynaptic terminal, whereas strychnine blocks the glycine release at the postsynaptic receptors. Why does tetanus spasmin cause increased blood pressure and pulse rate? At the preganglionic sympathetic neurons in the lateral gray matter of the spinal cord, the toxin inhibits the inhibitory neurotransmitters GABA and glycine and causes increased release of catecholamines that cause increased blood pressure and pulse rate. So, tetanus spasming causing hypertension due to inhibition of inhibitory neurotransmitter that causes increased release of catecholamine, causing increased blood pressure and pulse rate. The diagnosis of the tetanus. Diagnosis is done by clinical features, number one. The other features are increased WBC count, increased muscle enzyme. The CSF. How about the CSF in tetanus? CSF is normal, and electromyography. It shows continuous motor neuron discharges with absent silent interval. So the silent interval, which is normally present, they are absent in tetanus with continuous motor neuron discharges. And the antitoxin level of more than 0.1 international unit per ml indicates a negative tetanus. So, the presence of antitoxin level of more than 0.1 IU per ml indicates no tetanus. The treatment of the tetanus: quiet room to minimize stimulation. Number two, sedation and muscle relaxation for spasm and to prevent laryngospasm with benzodiazepines like diazepam, lorazepam, and a short-acting midazolam. Number three, cleaning and debridement of the infected wound. Number four, antibiotics. So, which antibiotics? Penicillin, 10 million units IV daily for 10 days. And for those with penicillin allergy, alternate is erythromycin or clindamycin. And instead of penicillin, alternatively, metronidazole 500 mg every 6 hourly may also be used. Number 5, for hypertension, short-acting esmolol by continuous infusion or clonidine or MagSulf, magnesium sulfate. Number 6, immunization, active or passive. Active immunization is done with vaccine. TT, tetanus toxoid, tetanus diphtheria and TDP may be done. Tetanus toxoid is given if the last vaccine dose was given more than 5 years ago or more than 10 years ago. And the passive immunization is done with human tetanus immune globulin. The tetanus immune globulin, what's the dose of that? 3000 to 6000 international units in divided doses, and a dose may be injected at or around the site of the injury. Antibodies do not cross the blood-brain barrier, so intrathecal dose may also be given. Now, answers to the questions: what's the location of organism and the toxin of Clostridium tetani? Answer is, organisms remain localized in the wound and the toxin is transported by nerves to the nervous system. Number 2, how tetanus spasmin reaches the nervous system. Tetanus toxin does not cross the blood-brain barrier. Number 2, neuronal transport is the sole means of entry into the nervous system. So it reaches the brainstem and spinal cord by retrograde axonal transport through the nerves. Now, how retrograde neuronal transport occurs? Tetanus spasmin is absorbed in the blood, enters the presynaptic terminals of the lower motor neuron. It's carried by retrograde axonal transport to the brainstem and spinal cord, and from there the toxin travels through the descending tracts to the anterior horns of the spinal cord, alpha motor neurons and the neuromuscular junction and motor nerve endings of the peripheral nerve and prevents neuromuscular release of GABA and glycine, causing hypertonia and rigidity and intermittent muscle spasms. What's the rate of transport of tetanus spasmin and its lethal dose? The rate of transport is about 3 to 13 millimeters per hour and the lethal dose is 2.5 nanogram per kg. Question number 5. When does paralytic tetanus occur? Paralytic tetanus occurs in cephalic tetanus when tetanus toxin acts like a botulinum toxin by blocking the release of neurotransmitter. Botulinum toxin blocks the release of the neurotransmitters at the presynaptic terminal. Similarly, in a cephalic tetanus, tetanospasmin blocks the release of the neurotransmitter at the presynaptic terminal, causing paralytic tetanus. How long does the passive immunity last from tetanus immune globulin? Passive immunity from a dose of 250 mg of tetanus immune globulin lasts for 4 to 6 weeks.